As I mentioned, I'm from Baltimore originally, from Maryland, so Harriet Tubman is something when we all grew up with the Tubman family, either in their contribution ending a slave, you know, all of the things that they didn't have much a part of American history, as much as any founding father that you can name, that they are founders of the country that we are today. But then, in addition to that, the suffragettes and the Martin Luther King, so other manifestations of the diversity of our country. One of my, let's say this one more thing. When I became a leader and then speaker, one of the things I wanted to do in the Capitol was to, in addition to having diversity in our caucus, to have diversity in the halls there, having all these men. So we had Rosa Parks, we had statue to Rosa Parks, we had Sojourner Truth, Helen Keller. These are acts of Congress that you have to have these statues, and sometimes right now we're trying to persuade states, for example, like Maryland, to vote to put Harriet Tubman there. See, replacing, there are 100 statues in Congress, 2 from each state, and it's up to the state legislature to choose who's there. And if they want to replace one, it's up to the state legislature to do that. And that's what they're in the process of doing. But unilaterally, just as we had passed legislation to expand, and we only had a couple of years, and we got 3, but we need many, many more. But that made a big difference in terms of at least we can take young children and show them. We have the women in the tub. That we call it women in the tub. It's Sojourner Truth. No. Harriet. No. Susan B. Anthony, Elizabeth Cady Stanton, and Lucretia Mott. If you go to the Capitol, you see these 3 women. The men said that they really didn't. Can you imagine this? Don't tell anybody I told you this. The men said at the time when we were lobbying to get that upstairs, this was several years ago, they said, we don't want that in the rotunda because they're not attractive. These people don't even have a clue. I mean, they don't even suspect how bad off it is to say something like that, right? But in any event, when you get the gavel and you get the statues, then that's a different thing.
I wanted to ask you a question, a little bit about politics. There's a common wisdom that the safe districts on both sides of the aisle lead to more extreme positions within the parties because the concern is about your primary from your flank rather than running for the center as a representative. And I wanted your take on whether you think that is true, a new development.
No, I don't think so. I mean, I think that there are, I would say that would be true of the Republican Party, but because, as I say, we're asking them to take back their party from the Tea Party and the rest of that, and quite frankly, the Tea Party in Congress looks just like the presidential candidates running for president in terms of their statements on the floor, in committee, and in press conferences. They sound very much alike, even though there are those in the party who are shocked by what they're saying on the presidential level. We hear it every day in the Congress. So perhaps on their side, because they do have this absolute ideological wing in their party. But in our side, if a district is Democratic and somebody challenges somebody, it's not because they weren't liberal enough. It's just because of generational ambition, you know, it's really other reasons. So I myself, just to get to a larger point on this, fully support as a commission redistricting. I think that there should be, we're trying to pass a law, we won't get it passed now, but we have to win to do for commission redistricting, so that every state has an independent commission that does almost agnostic redistricting about how states should be redistricted and affecting representation in state legislature and in the Congress. I don't think it would make that much difference on our side of the aisle, but I think it might make a difference on their side. because what the Republicans say to me when I say take back your party, they say we can't beat them in the primary. You have to beat them in the general, and then we'll come back and beat you. You know, in other words, I'm just telling you what they say. But you know, people represent their constituents. You know, that's the way it is. Your title and your job description are one and the same, representative. So you represent your constituents. If there's an element of your party that goes to an extreme place, then that's up to you all to work out. But that doesn't mean that the whole system is polarized because that. We're polarized. Here's the deal. Here's what the election should be about if we could have a civil conversation about it. It's trickle-down economics. Special interest, big tax breaks at the high end, trickle down. If it trickles down, that would be good. If it doesn't, so be it. That's the free market. Versus middle-class economics, which says our economy will never turn around fully unless we increase the paychecks of American workers. And that purchasing power in a consumer economy is what turns the economy around. So while we've had tremendous advances in our economy, taking it from nearly a depression, rescuing it on its way to a depression, that when the president stood on the steps of the Capitol to take the oath, President Obama, unemployment was more than 10. It's around 5. The deficit was $1.4 trillion. It's 500 and some billion. We still want it lower, but nonetheless, 70% lower. The 73 straight months of job creation, over 14 million jobs created. The auto industry was on its heels, and now it's thriving. We were hoping ever to get to double digits in selling cars in those days, maybe 9 to 10 million cars, 17.3 or 4 million this past year. So much of N, more than 20 million people have access to affordable quality health care. The market was around 6,500. It's now over 17,000, a difference of 10,000 points. But still, people are feeling the pain because of wage stagnation. And that is what the election is about. It's about your values. It's about your value. What do you think makes our democracy strong? A strong middle class is the backbone of our democracy. And the decisions we make about investments in education to lift people up to the middle class, allocation of resources, R&D, whatever, as well as revenue tax policy make the difference in the lives of the American people. So that is really the debate. It's not about how negative you can be about certain ethnic groups or certain religious groups or the rest. That's in the discussion. But the fact is, if we can have the debate and let the American people choose, do you want to trickle down and take your chances on that? Or do you want... So what we say is, show us your values. Show the American people your values. And the place you find people's values in the legislative process is in their budget. So I keep saying to them, show us your budget. Show us your budget so people can see what your priority is. Is it your priority to eliminate the guarantee of Medicare? That's in the budget. You know, so let people see what is the tangible manifestation of your values. Budget is supposed to be a statement of our national values. What is important to our country should be what we invest in. And so, when you get back to this, people get elected from their districts. They have represent the point of view of their district. And I think we can redistrict differently, but I would not attribute all of the challenges that we face to that. I'm trying not to be political.
Thank you for that answer. I love that that line. Where do you look for your values? In the legislature, it's in
show me your budget.
Show me your budget. So I've got one more, and then we're going to take questions from roving mics in the audience. So ready your thoughts. Constitution, you mentioned a brilliant document more than 200 years ago, an utterly different time.
Thank God they made it amendable.
In our country.
That was brilliant.
Well, it's tough to amend, but I'm giving you magical power right now.
Yeah.
If you could magically change one thing about our system to change the Constitution, you know, from your perspective as a legislature, in the legislature, what would that one change be?
Well, it wouldn't be about changing the Constitution, but it would be about changing a court decision in regard to the Constitution, and that is Citizens United. One of the most undemocratic, it's really hard to grasp how they could have made that decision, destructive to our democracy. And that is in a partisan thing. The Democrats, Republicans, across the country, people know that having endless, undisclosed, special interest money weigh in on campaigns is not the Democratic way. And to say corporations are people and they don't, if you made a contribution, you have to report it. But if they make a contribution, they don't. So they must be a special kind of people or something, if you want to call them people. But I know that Congresswoman Beatty has been just so on the forefront on this. Because you know what? If you want to elect, as our goal is, more women, more minorities, more young people to Congress, two things. I guarantee you this. I guarantee you, if you do these two things, you will have that result. Reduce the role of money in politics and increase the level of civility in the debate. More women, more young, because people will come forward and run. You know, I had $100 million spent against me describing me in one way or another because I was effective. I mean, they wouldn't have done it if I were not effective, says she immodestly. But, I mean, women, you have to be confident about all of this, or else, you know, because you're going into the arena, and they're going to throw a punch, so you got to be ready to take it, or possibly even throw one from time to time. But the thing is this. People, I didn't mind that they did that to me. I mean, I didn't like that my grandchildren had to see that and all that. But apart from that, I'm in the arena. But what I didn't like about it is when we would try to encourage women to run, they would say, well, you know what? I'm a professional woman. Look at Joyce Beatty. She was in higher echelons of Ohio State University, a private businesswoman, a small businesswoman herself. So when you're approaching people like that, who are so excellent, they'll say, look, I have options. I could be this, I could be that, I could be this. Why should I subject myself to millions of dollars describing me as some kind of person that my neighbors would not even recognize and bring my children home crying from school? I said, well, because of two things. First of all, it's urgent. We need more women. And second of all, we don't want people without options. Yeah, we want people with options. If you said to me, I don't have anything else to do, I think I'll run for Congress. You know. I mean, I can't get a job, so I think I'll run for Congress. That's not what we want, people with options. And we have just remarkable, I mean, I think you'd be so proud. When I have my House Democratic Caucus, I keep saying to them, look around you. Under this roof, as you sit in this room, is the greatest collection of intellect, integrity, and imagination for making progress for America's working families. And you just go from one to the other, and every one of them a blessing. And so that's what you want. You want the quality of it all. So if there's one thing I could change, it would be the Citizens United. Everything we do, and this was, so I'll go back to the Obama administration, everything we want to do in government, again, respectful of other people's views and humble enough to accept a different point of view, is about expanding freedom in our country. So look at President Obama. The first bill he signed, which we sent him, was the Lilly Ledbetter Act to eliminate discrimination in the workplace. The last bill he signed was the repeal of Don't Ask, Don't Tell, ending discrimination in the military. Everything in between was about giving people more opportunity, investments in education and the rest, and strengthening our democracy by expanding freedom and recognizing that our founders thought that the democracy should be about an educated electorate. The next thing is about leveling the playing field, and they almost go together right here at Ohio State. Education. It's about informed electorate for our democracy, about education leveling the playing field, because education is the key to it all. And that's why this institution looms so large, not just because of what it does for its students, but what it does for American competitiveness and just imagination and all the rest to take us forward, recognizing that innovation begins in the classroom. So expand freedom, level the playing field, and in doing so, again, strengthening democracy. And that's why you have to reduce the role of money, because there's an undue impact. Our founders, I go back to them all the time, sacrificed, in their words, their lives, their liberty, and their sacred honor for a democracy, a government of the many, not a government of the money. How would they feel if they saw what was happening now and all of the initiatives to block participation at the voting booths? You see some of that here. Are we going to the audience?
Well, now we're
going to
go to the audience. So thank you. So raise your hand and our student will come with Mike.
Thank you, Leader Pelosi, for coming. There's an ongoing debate in the judiciary on the role of legislative history in interpreting statutes. Could you speak to...
Let me just put that in the context of the people we serve with. In the beginning of the 2000s, in the, say, 2003, 2004, 2005, there were those in Congress, I don't sound political, that challenged Marbury versus Madison. They had been doing it for a long time. Marbury versus Madison was the court decision more than 200 years ago that said that the court had the right of judicial review of legislation. They said that Marbury versus Madison was wrongly decided. So they would put forth bills that would be challenges to the court to do that. One of them is well known. It's the so-called Defense of Marriage Act, DOMA, the Defense of Marriage Act. Now, they knew that was unconstitutional. They knew. I mean, when it passed in the House, it had like 67 votes or something like, I mean, against, that 67 votes against. This was in the late 90s. President Clinton, it was put on his desk. He signed it. But they knew it was unconstitutional. So in the, five, 10 years later, half a dozen years later, they put forth this court-stripping bill, and they had a series of them, but this one court-stripping bill about DOMA that said that the court does not have the right to review the constitutionality of DOMA. Why would they do that if they thought it was constitutional? So when we went to the court for the argument, the legal arguments on DOMA, they were saying, the Chief Justice was saying, what was the view at the time as to whether it was constitutional? And the lawyers were saying this or that. I felt like jumping up and saying, they knew right then and there. But you don't do that in the court. In fact, you don't even fix your glasses because they think you're taking a picture or something. It's a very strict place. So this is a very philosophical thing among some in the Republican Party. Barry Goldwater rejected. Now I'm going back along to this. It rears its head. Try again. I want the women here that I want to run for office to know that you have to have a little bit of immodesty about it all and some confidence about it. But I did op-ed that said we're going to win. Every interview I had on TV, they said, "What are you going to do?" Blah, 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 blah. The court overturns Affordable Care Act. It's not going to happen. Well, what are you going to do if it's not going to happen? It's not going to happen. It's going to be 6-3 or whatever. It's going to be 6-3. I was wrong. It was 5-4. But nonetheless, I thought we would get Kennedy. I knew we would get the chief because I read all of his stuff. And if you, I'll send you my op-ed, which I quote him in. He basically says that it isn't the business of the court to, you know, I don't agree with this policy, therefore I overturn it. It's about, is it constitutional? And when we wrote that bill, we knew what the challenges would be after. We made it, law students, ironclad. Ironclad. So I didn't have the slightest doubt because of what the chief had said himself. I mean, a court can decide anything, and it shouldn't be a place where they say, I don't like this bill, so it's not constitutional. It has to be about the Constitution. But it is important for us to have our full complement on the court, and this is another manifestation of obstruction of the president that hurts the third branch, the third branch of government, the judiciary, that the court, the Constitution says the president, in case of a vacancy, the president shall appoint, the Senate shall confirm, that they won't even give him a hearing. They can reject him. But to say that this president doesn't have a right to do that, it's just a stunning thing. But anyway, if you want to know more about it, come see us in our office because we've been tracking him on this Marbury versus. Imagine that they said Marbury versus Madison was wrong. So we're starting at a very different place between us. But on that bill now, right now, as you know, 4-4, it's only 8 members. 4-4 upholds the state. Let's whatever the state decide, courts, lower courts, not the state, but the lower court stand, and that could be helpful in some ways. It was on Friedrich's decision that related to workers, but it wouldn't. 4-4 doesn't help us on immigration, so we're hoping to get a break from one of the other members. Let me just talk to you about this on immigration for a second, and we may not have any more time for that. President Obama, I'm not a lawyer, so forgive me if I don't have all the terminology. I have 2 children of my 5 are attorneys, and they would be correcting me here. President Obama has used his executive authority to protect the dreamers and their parents in some cases. What President Obama did is in keeping with the legal authority to do so. The legislation is there that supports what he did. But even over and above that, since Eisenhower, presidents have exercised executive action in these terms. But let's get to President Ronald Reagan, President George Herbert Walker Bush, who did more percentage-wise than President Obama is doing with his executive order. In fact, President Obama acted because Congress didn't act. Congress didn't act. President Reagan, bless his heart, he acted after Congress acted to protect certain people in our country, and he said, you didn't go far enough. So I'm going to institute family fairness where we're protecting more members of the family, and President George Herbert Walker Bush followed his lead, and between them they did more than President Obama is doing. And that would be the last term of Reagan and the first and the only term of George Herbert Walker Bush. So in the same period of time as President Obama has been in office. So by precedent and law, he's absolutely right. Where they go to find him not to be wrong, apart from the fact that this court in South Texas came up with that, it would be really destructive to, was it going to be retroactive to all the people that President Reagan welcomed and President George Herbert Walker? And by the way, let me just say this about my friend George W. Bush. He was one of the best presidents on immigration that we have had. We worked very closely with him on immigration. He couldn't believe that his own party walked away from him on that subject. In fact, in one of those meetings, you know, the floor and the president, he said, I think that when we went in to talk about the legislative agenda, the first thing he said is, well, now, we're in the majority, now we can pass immigration reform. And Senator McConnell said, oh, no, Mr. President, we don't have the votes. And he said, what do you mean you don't have the votes? You have all of these names as co-sponsors of the immigration bill. And he said, well, just because they co-sponsored it doesn't mean they're going to vote for it. And the president was really kind of like, what? And because this was one of his priorities, you know, being from Texas and all, and it was in his family tradition, you know, really, sincerely, a great president on immigration, but his party was not going to go there. And you see why when you hear their statements, which are, these presidential are a reflection of what we hear every day in the Congress. But anyway, to take it back to the court, that's the challenge that we have. So on Affordable Care Act, all of a sudden there were big, you know, big court advocates. The court should decide. But before they were court stripping, then when the Affordable Care came along, they were like, well, the court has to decide whether this is constitutional or not, whereas they were saying, we're tired of these activist courts. We're not even going to fund their decisions and all the rest of that. So it's part of the national debate. It shouldn't be. I mean, the court should be something that you think it's about the Constitution or conflicts between states or, you know, what the jurisdiction of the Supreme Court is. Do we have time for one more?
I think
more?
We have time for one quick question.
We have to have a woman this time, right? My answers are too long, I know. But.
So you have Professor Johnson.
Professor
Johnson. My question is about, you said you want more women to run. And I'm concerned about payday lending. And as you know, Congress is filled with folks who come from the middle class or upper middle class who don't understand the struggles of people who rely on payday lending. So my question is, how are you getting more women who actually understand the struggles of the working class who have to rely on payday lending in order to support Richard Cordray and the CFPB to basically get loans that people can afford to pay back?
Did my thing go off? No, here we go. I turned wrong. Excuse me, Professor. On the payday lending, in our country, again, this is a place where we have some division between the aisle separates us on, but you would be surprised, I think, how many people in America do not have a net worth of $1,000? They work full-time. Many of them make the minimum wage. They can't afford to put food on the table. They have very little in terms of savings or net worth. $1,000. You would be surprised at what these same working people pay for access to their own money. We're talking billions of dollars in a year. It's horrible. You probably would also be surprised at the stories of some of our colleagues. Joyce knows this. I have colleagues who grew up in situations where one of them loves to cook. And I said, you know, it's so wonderful that you cook. And she said, you know why? Because we didn't even have food to eat in our family when I was growing up. We had to take turns eating. This is a distinguished, high-ranking woman in the Congress. Another one, so beautifully dressed all the time. I said, oh, you always look so lovely. She said, you know why? Because we didn't have clothes. When my father had to go to the doctor, he had to borrow my uniform blouse for a shirt to go barefoot to the doctor. So the experience, there are, I mean, I'm not saying that everybody is that way, but I am saying there are a large number, larger than you would ever expect, of members of Congress who have lifted themselves out in a way, and that is why they know that we have to have policies that address just what you described. And when we put in, and I Again, that was a bill that we wrote, the Wall Street Reform Bill and the rest, where we put the Consumer Protection Agency in there. We knew it was going to be a target from day one because the interest that had been milking that situation for such a long, to this minute, still fight any changes that we have there. And that's all part of the trickle-down versus middle class. What is your overarching value system? Is this about fairness? Is it about opportunity? Or is it... May I just close by talking about Flint, Michigan? Flint, Michigan. It might surprise you to know that in Flint, Michigan, the people there spend more per month on water, like $140 a month for water that is poisoning their children. There are some elements in our economy that consider poor people a cash cow. Does that accurately reflect what I'm telling you? A cash cow, because there's so many of them. So every little bit. And payday lending is part of all of that. So when we have this consumer protection, we never had anything like that, but we said if we're going to make a difference, we have to have it there. Cordray, thank you for sending him. He's so fabulous, but always under attack. Because you know what? Money. And really, that, when you go out into a campaign, you don't want to be a fear monger. You know, you want to try to talk about hope and the future. Elections are about future. But there are really bad things that stem from your basic premise of who are you there for? And how open are you to even understanding, forget decency. Forget fairness. Forget compassion. Just be pragmatic. It's better if these people have a bigger paycheck or in a stronger position to consume to lift up the economy, right? I mean, in other words, if you want to forget all the reasons that we are a community. Remember, the word community and opportunity have the same word in them, unity. The unity of our country is about America, about all of us, all. Liberty, we take everything. I pledge allegiance to that. With liberty and justice for all. But that's not what happens every day. And so how do you go into a campaign and say, if you only knew, you don't want to do that. That's not who we are. We're messengers of hope. So you try to figure out what are the messages that will get people to the polls. Mr. Clyburn, who's our assistant leader, works with Joyce Beatty. Joyce Beatty works in many capacities as part of the message group, as part of the whip operation, as part of the everything, to get this connection between the vote and your life. Martin Luther King, the ballot, the ballot, the ballot. Legislation, legislation, legislation. Your life, your life, your life, what it means. And Walter Reuther, he said that the ballot box and the bread box cannot be separated. What you gain at negotiations can be eliminated through legislation if you're not electing people who share your values. So it's not about just voting Democratic. It's trying to change the mind, making sure that whoever you vote for understands what you expect of your representative in terms of fairness. And that's why the bright light has to be on. I would hope that it wouldn't even be a partisan issue that we care about fairness and how people access their own money, or that we say to a state, thank God they have at least some indictments now and they'll have more. You can't make a decision for your budget that it's cheaper for you to unleash poisoned water on the children of Flint because you're going to save money in your budget. A completely false economy. Another false economy is when they say we're going to cut and freeze Pell Grants so that we can keep the reduced, so we don't contribute to the deficit. Nothing, maybe this will be my last word, maybe, nothing Remember it? I have a few absolute facts here, like civility and money and politics. Nothing reduces the deficit more than investing in education. Nothing. Early childhood, K through 12, higher education, postgrad, lifetime learning for our workers. Nothing brings more money to the Treasury. So when they say to me, and I say, why don't you cut your special tax breaks for big oil? That will save us $38 billion. They said, why do you do that? You can cut that from Pell Grants. Show me your budget. Well, I am so delighted to be here with all of you. I really was hoping to be a little more, you know, up here, but we got into a little bit of the differences between us all. But that's what drives our engine. Again, an openness to finding common ground. We owe it to the American people. You have a brilliant member of Congress. From day one, she has made a tremendous difference, not only in her advocacy, but in her graciousness, her demeanor, how respectful she is of other people, and how that is returned to her. I know how proud and respected she is here. I want you to know how much we appreciate and respect Congresswoman Joyce Beatty in the Congress of the United States. And by the way, almost every day she has on scarlet, and almost every and every day she sings the praises of Ohio State University.
Speaking of which, Speaker, before I ask everyone to join me in thanking you, we have a little gift, and it's funny that you mention the scarlet and gray. You were the 52nd Speaker of the House.
Oh, wow! Let us thank Dean Michaels for how long my answers were, and he had many more questions to ask. But thank you for your leadership, for your friendship, and for your invitation to be here today.
Thank you.
Thank you all.